So we now move to the demonstration part of the webinar, and what we're going to cover here is a demonstration of some of the key features that we talked about through the slides, including Teams optimization, as well as browser content redirection. Now, what we're looking at here is the 10ZiG Manager server, where I'm going to demonstrate connecting to one of the 10ZiG endpoints and actually setting it up towards Citrix Cloud for the first time to get a feeling for how easy it is. And what this should demonstrate and offer to you is the look and feel around the Zero Trust security, where we start to see just how small that footprint of the client is, and the fact it provides really a bridge or an overlay towards Citrix Cloud and nothing more. So this is the 10ZiG Manager console. We've signed in essentially as an administrator here, and we can see any number of clients which are connected both within the organization as well as remotely, again, for either our remote or home workers or hybrid workers. Now, we can recognize clients whether they're online or offline, and this particular client that we're going to connect to here is just a client that I've got connected behind me in the office, as you see a second in the demo. It's the 10ZiG 6048 QC. So if we go ahead and we shadow that session, but actually before I do, let me just emphasize the fact that we can configure the endpoints automatically through the management tool. So we can either apply a pre-configured template, which is essentially an XML file that contains all of the configuration points for the endpoint, as well as configuring configuration groups and enable automatic configuration. But again, just to demonstrate the simplicity of the endpoint setup, I want to do it through VNC. So I'm just going to shadow the endpoint now to again demonstrate those few steps. So the first step that's presented is putting in this part of the configuration wizard, it's entering the country, which specifies things like the keyboard language and also time zone, if specific. So we are in the UK at the moment, so I'm going to select Great Britain here. We also then have to put in the time and date. And then the third and final step is specifying the credentials towards Citrix. Now, in this case, I'm going to connect to Citrix Cloud using the Citrix Ready environment that the Citrix Ready guys kindly provided for the purpose of this demo. Now, we also have a few connection types on offer here. Now, I'm going to leave it at the default, which is the receiver for web. And this provides the user with essentially a kiosk-based browser. So the user isn't permitted to go anywhere outside other than essentially pressing quit, as you'll see in a moment. And then the terminal can be further locked down, again, as I'll demonstrate shortly. Now, there's also, as choosing, the ability to use the Citrix self-service to provide a consistent look and feel across different endpoints, so laptops, PCs, MacBooks, etc., as well as web API and PN agent. And customers tend to use that, for example, if they want to automate the connection. Let's say they have users who want to auto-launch a specific desktop or a specific app. That's the sort of connection type that we tend to use in that scenario. But again, I'm just going to leave it at the default, which is receiver for web. I will just quickly look at some of the options that we covered throughout the slide. So Teams optimization, again, this is where we can override the performance if, for example, we either want to reduce or increase the webcam encoding rate. So the override performance by default, as we can see, is disabled. Now, again, that works on the basis that it's negotiating with the underlying hardware to offer up to 720p, which is the current default. But again, I can go in here and I can override these if I so choose. But as was covered in the slide, the performance estimator these days does a pretty damn good job at calculating the actual performance size. So it's only really if you want to reduce it, again, to either reduce bandwidth or upscale the experience. We didn't cover it specifically in the slides, but it will be covered later on. We do have support for Cisco WebEx, and as part of the continual advancements for that, we have recently bundled in multiple versions of the WebEx Meetings plugin to support users with different versions. If we go to Advanced, these are some of the more Citrix Advanced features. So if we enable the connection bar, which I generally like, so it offers the overlay at the top of the desktop. I also like to use the session end key, so I like to hit F12 to end my session, as well as showing hostname, which is a common feature that we recommend to use, as you'll see in a second. Now, we also have where you want to force them on the HDX adaptive transport that we mentioned. Now, again, that does force it on, but it does work in a negotiated state by default anyway, where it will negotiate EDT by default and fall back to TCP where not available. So we click on OK there, and after clicking OK, the endpoint will go ahead and automatically launch the receiver for web, which again is then taking me to the connection feed at Citrix Cloud, where I'm required then to enter login credentials. Now, just before I go ahead and enter those credentials, I'm just going to do a couple more things. Firstly, we're going to lock down the terminal as we would for any normal user. So we put in a password, and from that point forwards, it will block user access into the control panel. And we can also allow user-based properties. So let's say, for example, we want this user just to adjust their display layout as well as their sound, things like volume settings and audio devices, as well as actually either powering the endpoint off or rebooting. And again, for the purpose of the demo specifically, I'm just going to turn temporarily the SSH client on so that we can hook into the endpoint to look at some of the offload features in terms of how much load they're creating on the 10ZiG endpoint. So I'm going to go ahead and click OK here. We're going to close the control panel. Now again, just as a simple final check, before I go ahead and log into Citrix, now if we go into the settings, we're presented with a password, and similarly, the launchpad only offers the user the ability of powering down, setting the display properties, and or setting the audio properties or login. So again, from that point forwards, we've essentially locked down the endpoint through a simple series of steps and give the user just the very basic ability of connecting to Citrix Cloud. So we reconnect to Citrix Cloud. I'm just going to enter the credentials that were offered to me. And there we're taken into Citrix Workspace, where after authentication, the user's presented with any available sets of applications and desktops. Now, for the purpose of the demo, I'm just going to go ahead and connect to this W10 AMD-based desktop. And there we are. So we're connected into the Citrix Cloud-based desktop now. This desktop is based in the around Texas in the US, I believe. So we can just check what our latency is like once we get into the desktop. Let's go ahead and just go into a command prompt. And if I reel off CTX session minus V, what this offers me is some details about the things like the latency, for example. So we can see the last latency is around about 137 milliseconds, as well as the average latency. So that's typical of what we would expect to get by connecting across to the US from the UK, obviously, where you're connecting to a regional based deployment, you would expect that to be far less. So let's go ahead and close that out. So it's already fired up Teams. Now, for anybody that's used Teams in an optimized form before, you'll know what to do, but for those that haven't, let me demonstrate. So if we go into the settings of Teams, let's go into About and Version. And as we can see, it offers us the version of Microsoft Teams, as well as the fact that it's functioning in an optimized mode. But furthermore, if we go back to the settings and we go into Devices, what this will start to do is it will pass through any headsets or webcams that are connected to the physical endpoint, which you can see me pointing to behind me. So I could go in here, for example, and I could select the Plantronics Blackwire headset that's physically connected to the endpoint behind, as well as select the HD or the Logitech B910 webcam that's again connected to the endpoint. So again, the virtual desktops in Central Time America, and the devices are connected locally behind me here. Now, if we go ahead and we just go into meeting, that will go ahead and it will start a meeting for the user that signed into Microsoft Teams behind me. Now, again, for anybody that's used Teams in an optimized mode before, you'll know that if you move the Teams application around, it's not quite clear here because of the way in which we're shadowing the client through VNC, but the video is essentially overlaid here. So there is a small transition as we move the Teams app around the desktop. But if we really want to see what's happening under the hood, we can go towards Task Manager here. And if we look at the, again, at the virtual desktop in this first instance, we can see that the CPU count here is really low, even though we've got a Teams desktop app in participating in the meeting. The CPU consumption is really low. And also, if we look at the Teams processes here, again, we can see it's just minimal. It's just very small signaling information between the Teams desktop app, but the kind of heavy lifting side of things is performed now on the endpoint. So if I bring this into view, what this is, this by turning on the SSH client, and going into top. Top is the performance monitor for Linux. So we can see the HDXRTC engine here is consuming around about 155% CPU. Now, bearing in mind it's a quad-core CPU inside this particular hardware, that's roughly, with all of the other processes as well, we're roughly consuming between sort of 45 to 50% on the CPU. So again, think about the shift in load as we transition the load from the virtual desktop towards the endpoint. Now, what isn't necessarily covered here is also the network transport side of things. So if we look again at the virtual desktop and we go to performance, we'll see the networking stats here are very low, even based on the fact that we've got this video call encoding from directly from the endpoint. We can see, therefore, the data or the network transmission is very low at the virtual desktop. Now, also, if we go here, we've got the large gallery and the together mode. So again, we're using those newer versions of Teams. You can switch into either the large gallery or the together mode. So again, remember the fact that the gallery mode is currently restricted to the 2x2 or a total of 4 participants. The large gallery is a 7x7 or 49 participants. And remember the way in which it's delivered to the endpoint as well. So the gallery, for the gallery view, which is the 2x2, you've essentially got the 4 video streams being sent towards the endpoint, and the endpoint decodes each one of those 4 streams individually, versus the large gallery or the together mode, where it's a singular stream sent from a central conference server, which in turn reduces the CPU overhead on the client, but increases the latency somewhat, as it's the central conference server that deals with all of the video stream encoding. And also for the together mode, the actual AI overlay that creates that auditorium type experience. So that concludes the Teams demo. Let's go ahead and demonstrate BCR, or Browser Content Redirection. So we've got Google Chrome here installed on the virtual desktop. Now, a couple of things just to note to begin with. Now, if we go to, let's say, for example, CNN, we can see that CNN is a good site to go to because it consists of a combination of video, text, and graphics. Now, what we can see here on the toolbar is the browser redirection extension. So where you're enabling browser content redirection, this is an extension that gets added to the Chrome browser. And where permitted through the whitelist, which I'll cover in a second, this then instructs the endpoint to effectively fetch that content on the virtual desktop's behalf. And again, as we saw in the slide overlay, it's the browser viewport, this area here, which essentially is redirected to the endpoint. Now, again, to confirm, browser content redirection isn't operating at this point in time. As we can see, it's a kind of transparent view for the BCR extension at the moment. And if we bring the task manager into view, you can see that if we go back to the users tab here, we can see at the moment that Chrome is consuming a certain amount of process overhead because of the fact that the site itself is being rendered and fetched on the VDA. Now, it is pretty minimal based on the fact that we've just got that small window interview there. But let's bring a live view into play, and we can see the consumption rises quite dramatically. Again, this is all on the VDA. So again, everything at the moment is being done on the VDA. Now, the other important thing to bear in mind is that as well as the browser rendering and fetching actually on the VDA, you've also then got the Citrix decoding overhead, which is also being performed on the virtual desktop. And that's what we can see here. So the Citrix graphic engine, again, all of this content that's being rendered on the browser at this point in time is being encoded on the virtual desktop. As well as then, if we look at performance, we can see the network in terms of what we're transmitting between the virtual desktop and the endpoint is sitting around just over 1 meg, sort of between 1 and 1.5 megabits. So that's not using browser content redirection, but fetching and rendering the content on the virtual desktop. And in transition on the endpoint is essentially just dealing with the normal Citrix decoding. So it's the WFICA real process here, which is fairly small, around about 31-35%, which again, overall, based on the fact we've run it across four cores, we're looking at about 20% overall load on the endpoint currently. Now, if we specifically switch to sites such as YouTube is a site that's featured in the whitelist. So it's a site that's effectively instructing the VDA and the browser to have the URL redirected towards the endpoint. Now, if we go ahead and let's just take a video here. Let's go ahead and play the video. Now, again, don't take too much from the performance here because remember the fact that we're actually shadowing the client remotely, so it is being hindered somewhat there. But if we go ahead and we play that content, and whilst the content's playing, we look at the performance. First of all, the network transmit and receive is very low because again, it's now the endpoint that's fetching that content on the VDA's behalf. And also again, note that the CPU load has dramatically reduced. And we can see that again, if we go to the users tab and we look at the user that's currently signed into the desktop and note the fact that Chrome is more or less just sat idle. It's the whole browser viewport that's being offloaded to the endpoint. And the Citrix graphics engine is also reduced because again, the browser viewport is now being completely offloaded. So really the only thing that is being encoded by the Citrix graphics engine is anything outside the browser viewport, as well as task manager here as well. Now, again, whilst that video is playing, let's just bring the endpoint into view. And here we can see the web container process that's running on the 10ZiG endpoint. So again, fairly low, fairly modest, around about 27 to 30% CPU. Now, if we were to go ahead and full screen that, let's just see how that adjusts accordingly. So once we full screen that to the endpoint, we can see that the overall consumption increases to between sort of 50 to 60%. So we can see the net effect of offloading that content to the endpoint. So that concludes the demonstration. It was hopefully a good demonstration of the fact that we're offloading some of these techniques, either Teams optimization or browser content redirection, to the endpoint, as well as in the initial setup, offering a very simple yet effective launchpad for users to connect to Citrix Cloud. So hopefully you enjoyed the demo.